Can you imagine a world where doing something as simple as brushing your teeth is difficult? A world where washing your dishes is challenging. A world where that morning cup of coffee is almost elusive. A place where you keep dropping things. What about typing on a keyboard? What if this was completely insufferable? What if your body limits you from doing everyday tasks? Your laundry. Cleaning the house. Driving. Eating. Drinking. Celebrating with your friends and family. The list is endless. Unfortunately, for some people, this is more than a contemplative exercise, more than a thought experiment, more than imagination. For some people, this is reality. Decoding dystonia for my eyes. So why don't all of us live in these shoes for a few minutes? Here, let's put this on to see dystonia from a different perspective. Man, there goes my hand cramping again. These contractions are really infuriating, not to mention the pain with them. I can't even brush my teeth without peace. Don't get me wrong, I love technology, but sometimes working on my computer all day, well, this can be really challenging. I don't have full control over the keyboard, and just after a while, my hand just starts to hurt and cramp up. Even washing my dishes, this can be a problem. One sudden tremor and I lose complete control. Yeah, just like that. Well, this is probably the thing that's most embarrassing, especially around people. I can't always hold on to stuff, and I know it's out of my control, but I wish it wasn't. Just one tremor and boom, it's on the ground.
Oh my god, what's wrong with him? Why is he shaking so much? I've never seen something like this before. What's going on?
Well, that was just a few minutes. Imagine every day. I just wish more people knew about this disorder. If more people knew, I'm sure it would make things easier. What is dystonia? Dystonia is a specific movement disorder that is characterized by either intermittent or even sustained muscle contractions that induce atypical movements, postures, or tremors that are usually repetitive. Dystonia is a disorder that affects 2 to 50 cases per million for early onset dystonia and 30 to 7,320 cases per million for late onset dystonia. Types of dystonia. Dystonia can be classified into 5 main categories. The first type is generalized dystonia. This is when the disorder affects most or all of the body. The second is Hemi Dystonia, where the effects are localized to one half of the body, such as the right side. Next, we have Multifocal Dystonia. This affects 2 or more distant or unrelated body parts, such as a leg and an arm. The fourth type is Segmental Dystonia. This involves 2 or more adjacent body parts, such as an arm and a hand. And finally, we have focal dystonia. Here, the effects are localized to one body part, as seen in the video before. So what exactly causes dystonia? Unfortunately, many dystonia cases are considered idiopathic, which means the direct cause is unknown because of the complexity of this disorder. Dystonia can be inherited genetically, and different genetic malformations can lead to different types of dystonia. The most common and widely known is DTY1 dystonia. The vast majority of these cases are caused by a specific mutation within a specific gene. However, dystonia can also be acquired through damage to specific areas in the brain by strokes, infection, tumors, oxygen deprivation, poisoning, and just general trauma. So what exactly are the signs and symptoms of dystonia? Although the onset of dystonia varies from 5 to 38, the most common form usually manifests around 19 years of age. Typically, dystonia affects the basal ganglia and the cranial area of the brain, as well as muscles throughout the body in the face, throat, lungs, and limbs. There are numerous hallmark symptoms of dystonia, including speech difficulties, dragging leg, hand and foot cramps, and uncontrollable blinking. Now let's take a look at the two main physical signs that are clinically present in most dystonia patients. First, we have dystonic movements. This is when the movements result in tremors, the movement is repetitive or patterned, and usually sustained. The second are dystonic postures. In this, various body parts are contracted uncontrollably, and there's a general deterioration in fine motor skills. In terms of treatments, unfortunately, there is no cure for dystonia. However, there are many viable treatments that can significantly improve quality of life. The first treatment are botulinum injections. In this method, the botulinum neurotoxin is injected into individuals' muscles. This toxin reduces the excessive muscle contractions and overall activity seen in dystonia. Normally, these injections are more suited for dystonias that affect one or two areas of the body. Transcranial magnetic stimulation is another option. This involves the emission of low-frequency magnetic stimulation onto someone's head. This treatment option helps reduce uncontrollable movements. This is a relatively new treatment option, and preliminary evidence shows that it can be effective with repeated stimulation. Next, we have deep brain stimulation. This is the most commonly used surgical treatment for dystonia that results in extreme disabilities. This treatment involves the implantation of electrodes within the patient's brain. These electrodes are connected to a stimulator that is also surgically implanted into the chest. The electrodes within the brain transmit impulses that reduce the intensity of muscle contractions. And finally, we have physical treatments. These are often used in conjunction with other treatments to improve outcomes. These treatment options include speech and physical therapy, motor learning exercises, and various muscle relaxing medications. And now, you know a little bit about dystonia. But learning isn't enough. We all need to play a part in health advocacy. Even in today's advanced world, there are numerous incurable disorders and diseases. These unfortunate conditions only have treatments. In some cases, these treatments can be very effective, vastly improving the quality of life. However, in many other instances, these treatments only have limited effects. In these situations, it is the duty of society to help improve their lives, to help create an enabling environment. A world that accommodates specific needs, not just for the average person, but for all people.